So urban wildlife is really any species that can benefit from living in an urban area. So that usually means species that are able to benefit from some of the resources that cities can provide. That might be in the form of concentrated food resources, that might be in the form of shelter. It can also be in the form of reduced predation, say, for some prey species.
I think when most people think of urban wildlife, they immediately think of animals that are kind of a nuisance, right? Things like pigeons and rats, or maybe something like squirrels. So I think a lot of people don't understand there's an amazing diversity of animals that live around us all the time, right? There's a tremendous amount of natural wonder around us all the time that we really just have to open our eyes to realize that it's so much more than just those pigeons.
So the biggest misconception that I encounter often with urban wildlife is that animals aren't supposed to be here. So we often hear from people who see maybe a coyote or see a deer or some animal that they're not expecting to find in an urban area, that they're not supposed to be here and that we should try to help them get out and go to some more natural habitat. But in fact, a lot of those animals are perfectly fine here. They've found their way here. They've set up their homes here. They figured out how to live around humans really successfully. And so most of the time, there's really no need to intervene. They're just going about living their lives and in many cases being really successful at it.
The Urban Wildlife Institute is a group of researchers within the Department of Conservation and Science at Lincoln Park Zoo. And we're a small but mighty team that focuses on wildlife that live in cities. We focus mainly on animals that live in Chicago, and we've been studying animals in Chicago for over a decade. The nice thing about studying urban wildlife is that it's really relevant to people's day-to-day lives because basically all of us encounter animals, whether you know it or not, on a day-to-day basis. And so we try to use the results of our research to make recommendations for how to live more wildlife friendly.
Yeah, so we use motion-sensor cameras for a lot of our research, and they're basically just small trail cameras that you can put out and tie to a tree. They're pretty inconspicuous, so most people don't really notice them in the green spaces that we're sampling. And what's really great about this technology is that they've come a really long way. They're fairly inexpensive now and have really high photo quality. And they take a photo when an animal walks in front of it. So we're able to see what species are out there, what types of habitat they're using, when they're using those habitats. And we can really learn a lot about animals that, historically we were never able to do just by observation alone. So the types of sites that we're sampling for our long-term research are cemeteries, golf courses, forest preserves, and city parks. The reason that we're focusing on those habitats is that's really what makes up the bulk of the kind of publicly available wildlife habitat here in Chicago. We've been doing this work here in Chicago since 2010. So it's been going on for over 14 years now and is considered to be the largest data set of urban wildlife anywhere. We've been sampling over 100 sites during that time period, of course, amassing millions of photos and even more species classifications in those photos. Around 2018 or so, we realized that we were, learning so much about Chicago, but there was still much more to learn about how animals were responding to urbanization across the world. So we created this network of partners called the Urban Wildlife Information Network. And now the study design that we created here in Chicago is now being replicated across this network. Over 50 partners around the world are using the same study methods that we've honed here in Chicago.
One of the most exciting things about the Urban Wildlife Information Network is that by working with these partners, we have created easily the largest and most robust data set for urban wildlife anywhere in the world. There's really never been anything like it before. Before the Urban Wildlife Information Network, there were many urban wildlife researchers who all had their own data sets in their own backyards, collected different ways at different times of year, using different technologies. Individually, very useful to understand wildlife in their city, but was not moving us towards a more global understanding of urban wildlife. And the Urban Wildlife Information Network, or UWIN, lets us take an enormous step towards understanding why wildlife live where they live, not just in one spot, but anywhere. A critical goal that the zoo had when they first started the Urban Wildlife Institute and later the Urban Wildlife Information Network was that we would do research that would really change the way people live with wildlife. Not just research to help us understand wildlife in kind of an esoteric or scientific way, but that would really help us to enable wildlife to be conserved and protected in cities, and that would create more positive interactions between humans and wildlife in cities. So we can't do that alone as scientists, right? We have to partner. We have to partner with city planners, landscape architects, developers, in order to give wildlife a seat at the table when we're thinking about, oh, we're building a new skyscraper or a new neighborhood or even just a new home or a new backyard. How can animals have a little part of that discussion so that we think about how can we leave a little bit of space for some of these species that we want to leave a space for? So I am an ecologist, as are most of us that work in the Urban Wildlife Institute, and ecologists study the connections between things. And it turns out, of course, that everything on the planet is connected to each other in some way.
So One Health is a way of thinking about health that really emphasizes the connections between human health, animal health, and environmental health. And really the goal of One Health is to enhance the health of people, animals, and the environment. So you can think of it really pithy, like healthy people, healthy animals, healthy planet. And the goal is to really work towards win-win solutions where we make clean environments that support healthy wildlife populations, and that means fewer health risks for people. The health of animals and people can be connected because animals can carry diseases called zoonotic diseases that can be transmitted from animals to people. The COVID-19 pandemic is a great example of an emerging infectious disease that originated in animals but then spread to people. But there are other zoonotic diseases like Lyme disease, where just by going outside and coming in contact with insects or other animals, we can contract illnesses that way. And so understanding how we can safely recreate outdoors is a big emphasis of ours to prevent these sort of disease risks. And then in terms of like how the environment plays into all this, it's really important in One Health to recognize that the same factors in the environment can affect the health of animals and people. This is important because ticks in the Chicago area can carry Lyme disease, which is a chronic illness that can be fatal. And so even though it's rare, it's important for people to understand that we want folks to recreate outside, but you just have to be aware that, you know, there are steps you can take to prevent tick bites, like pulling up your socks, wearing insect repellent, avoiding walking through tall grass, things like that. As part of our One Health work, we've been studying community gardens in Chicago because community gardens are really valuable resources for urban wildlife, particularly pollinators, because these are places in really dense urban neighborhoods where people are providing native plants and other flowers that can provide resources to bees, butterflies, and wasps.
Very often people ask me how they can be a part of our research, and the quickest and easiest way is to go to chicagowildlifewatch.org. That is our citizen science platform, where we put all of the images from our motion-triggered cameras on this website, and we ask the public to look at them with us and help us figure out what animal is in what image. So within, you know, 3 or 4 clicks, just a few seconds, even on a mobile device, you can be looking at these images, helping us figure out what's there, and really being a part of our research team. I think it's such a cool platform that enables us to connect our work to people all around the world.
We often say, observe, don't disturb. So, you know, really keep your distance from wildlife, really be able to kind of slow down and see what they're doing and kind of observe their behavior, perhaps their interactions that they might have with other species or with the plants or the trees that they're using.
One of our biggest recommendations is simply to stash your trash. A lot of negative human-wildlife interactions stem from animals accessing garbage and seeing our homes and businesses as a place to find food. This is really central to the Chicago Rat Project because that's basically why there are so many rats and why they come into our buildings.
I think there's 3 main reasons that people should care about urban wildlife. The first is that when we live in cities and animals live in cities, it can create conflict, right? This could be everything from a raccoon that knocks over your trash cans at night to the deer that maybe you hit with your car, or the coyote who maybe attacks your dog if you let it off leash. Understanding urban wildlife enables us to reduce these conflicts. It enables us to avoid these negative situations. The second reason is because cities are nature. Cities are a form of nature. No matter where you live, anywhere on the planet, you live in a form of nature. And I think we should care about urban wildlife because they are our neighbors, because they're a part of our lives, whether we like it or not. None of you came into work without passing by many, many species of wildlife that were above your head, that were on the streets, that were probably hiding in bushes and vegetation around you. As a zoo, I think it's part of our mission to connect people to nature, and I think the place to start with that is where we live. The third reason to care about urban wildlife is that if you care about biodiversity on our planet, and you know that cities are growing, more and more people live in cities in the United States, more than 80% of people live in cities. And if you care about conservation, at some point, we're gonna have to do some of that work here where we live. We can't push it all off into these nature preserves that we create far away from human habitation. Not when the city keeps urbanizing as quickly as it does.
There can be a misconception that cities are just terrible habitat for wildlife, that it's gonna cause poor health for everybody. But there are lots of examples where animals are recovering in cities because green spaces have been protected or harbors have been cleaned up from pollution. And so it's really important to bring in folks involved with environmental restoration or urban planning so we can figure out how to make these healthy green spaces that animals and people can both use to improve their health. At the Urban Wildlife Institute, we're always trying to connect our research with policy because that's really the way that we're going to make changes on the ground to protect both wildlife health and human health.